Good evening. How's everybody doing tonight? Y'all doing good? Hey, give us just a second. Let's make sure everybody's set up. All right, so tonight we got the real talent up here. Can y'all give them a round of applause? Don't they look good? Yeah. All right, enjoy our preschool choir tonight. Come on, didn't they do a great job? Y'all can do better than that. Come on. Let's give them a big round of applause. Yeah. Woo. Great job, everybody. I see some future competition for my job up here, for sure. They're going to go out and... Great job, everybody. Great job. We also get to start tonight out with a baptism, so if you'd turn your eyes up here, Ryan's, and do a baptism for us.
I'm sorry, now you gotta wait just for a second. It's okay. Well, good afternoon. I want to introduce Troy to you. We'll give him just a second. I thought it was going to be okay. This is Troy, and about 6 months ago, Troy asked Jesus into his heart, He's been talking with mom and dad over the last several months, and he is following through in believer's baptism this evening. So, Troy, who is the Lord of your life?
Jesus Christ.
Based on that profession of Jesus, I can baptize you my brother in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
What an incredible opportunity that we get when we come into this house and get to see somebody's life change and see them fall through in believer's baptism. Don't we get an amen on that?
Amen.
You know, it's so good to see everybody here tonight. Pastor Stephen just wanted me to let you know that, of course, he's not here tonight, but he'll be here Sunday. And so we're looking forward to all that God's going to do tonight, but also on Sunday. So you pray for all that will happen this Sunday as well. How was your Sunday, by the way? How was this past Sunday? Was it good? I hope that you were able to be here with us Sunday morning. But as we left here, probably like many of you, you probably want to have some traditions, baby. Did anybody go home to eat or have some lunch? Anybody got to do that? Well, that's what we did. It's a tradition for us. So we had a great time of worship here at church. And then we went home and the family all came together and love those traditions. But, you know, this year, some of the adults in our family decided, let's go ahead and make it a little bit easier. Have you ever done that? And now that's good for us, right? Now let's not do all the tradition stuff. That's a lot of work. And so we kind of put that out there. And so we've raised our grandkids well because they said, well, are we not going to have the green bean casserole? And we did. And then they found out that we weren't going to have the corn casserole. Well, we did. And then they found out we weren't going to have the hash brown casserole. And before it was over with, BB and Kristen and Aunt Kristen, they made all the stuff that we said we were not going to make for Sunday afternoon. I am thankful for grandkids. Are you not as well? But that's a great tradition for us. We love, I love to eat. You know, that's a great tradition. But also that what we like to do on the Sunday afternoons that we leave church, we like just to hang out a little bit. I don't know about you. And we went out in the backyards with the kids. I actually flew a kite with my two oldest grandkids. You know, kites are a whole lot easier to fly these days than they were back in my day. But man, we had that kite up there in the air, had a great time. But you know, another thing that we do during that Easter afternoon that we have together as a family after we leave services on Sunday morning, we get to sit around and talk. Do you like this, to have those conversations about what God's doing, about what happened that morning, about what Jesus means to us in our lives? Just have those conversations. Well, today we're going to see and hear about a conversation on an Easter day. So here's what's going to happen. We're going to come up and we're going to have an opportunity to worship in song. And then Bill Tucker, our minister of the military, is going to come up and he's going to read a passage for us from Luke 24 about two guys who was having a conversation. And then we're going to come back up and we're going to sing again. And I want to encourage you to worship tonight. And then we're going to come back and we're going to look at that conversation and that conversation, how it pertains to us and the conversations that we should have. Because, you know, Easter is not over with, is it? Now, we celebrated the fact on Sunday morning. But, folks, every day is Easter for that believer in Christ. And so I want to pray for us tonight. And after I pray, I want us to sing together. And I want us to sing to remember what Christ has done for us, because it's not an empty grave. And we celebrate that empty tomb and the resurrected Christ every day that he allows us to walk this earth. And so I think two people learned that on that same day that Christ rose, and we'll see that here tonight. But let's pray together. Father, tonight we just want to praise your name that we get to come into this house, that we get to come into your place, and that we get to worship together as family. And Father, we just pray tonight that you just take us where we are, that Father, that where we need to be changed, that you change us. And Father, where we need to be broken, that you break us. But Father, we pray this. We pray it's not about the person that's bringing the word here tonight, but it's about your word and that we look to you. And so, Father, we pray that you change us in such a way that when we leave this place tonight, that we go into this world and people see you in us. And so, Father, I thank you for each and every one here. Bless them. But, Father, bless this night as we come together to worship your holy name. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Stand with me as we sing together here tonight.
Evening, everybody. I'm going to be reading a passage of scripture from Luke 24. Luke 24, verses 13 through 36. It says, "Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together all of these things which had happened. So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained, so that they did not know him. And he said to them, 'What kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad?' Then the one whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him, Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem, and have you not known the things which have happened there in these days? And he said to them, What things? So they said to him, The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we are hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us when they did not find his body. They came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. Then he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Then they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone farther, but they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to stay with them. Now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, Did our heart not burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us? So they rose up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, The Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. And they told about the things that had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. Now as they said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said to them, Peace to you. You know, in these startling moments, as Jesus is raised from the dead, it's like in the most reassuring ways, Jesus gave them these words, Peace to you. And if you're not experiencing peace in your life tonight, then tonight's message is definitely for you. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you humbly, knowing our need of you. We love you, Lord. We thank you so much, Lord, for making yourself known to us, just as you did these two men walking to Emmaus. We thank you, Lord, that you're a God who knows our limitations, and yet you still reach into our lives. You work with us. You strengthen us and you grow us each and every day. Father, I just pray that, that you'll be in the words of Pastor Carl tonight as he brings those to us. Thank you, Lord, for the message that we'll receive. Thank you, Lord, also for what we can do with it as we go out into this world. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on, would you stand and worship with us tonight?
From the darkness I called your name. Into darkness your mercy came. You call me out, lifting me up. How great is your love. You bore my weakness, you took my shame, buried my lifting me up. How great is your love. From the heights of heaven, when you step down to earth, innocent perfection, you gave your life for us, and we are amazed. Yes, we
He's the one true God. Let's sing this together.
Well, there has never been, and there will never be, a God like you, a love so true. God like you, love so true. There has never been, and there will never be, a God like you, love so true. There has never been, and there will never be, a God like you, love so true.
praise you tonight. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God, you are worthy of all of our praise, and all of our love, all of our life, all of our time, all of our money. God, you are worthy of it all. So we give you all the praise and all the glory tonight. This is in the holy and precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
I think before I even get started here tonight, I need to get this off my chest. You know, when you preach and people share something negative to you before you walk up into the pulpit, that's not a good thing, is it? And so I just need to share this tonight to all of you and just make you aware. So when I was walking in here, I was asked a question. Who did you choose to win the NCAA tournament? Now, I'm just going to tell you, yes, I've kind of picked with my heart, not my mind. And yes, I did pick Baylor, as you probably would guess. But here's the good news. You know, I'm in a bracket, and I'm in the top 10 still. Now, there's only 10 people in the bracket, but that's okay. But let me tell you a little bit about that. You know, this last season, at the end of the season, the last game at Baylor University, I was planning on going to, but because of other reasons, I could not. And it was against a team that was leaving that conference and had played. It was a rival of Baylor for over 100 years. And so I'm thankful they are gone. And but we were going to go to that game, but I watched it on TV. And so I was watching it on TV. The problem is that I get a little emotional. Does anybody get a little emotional when you watch a ball game? Anybody like that? So I'm kind of even shouting a little bit. And so it's one of those things that Brenda will go into the other room and watch TV with the TV turned off. I mean, not off, the sound turned off, which I don't understand. And I'm watching in the other room with the TV sound up, and I get as loud as the TV sound. But I'm into the game. And just to let you know, Baylor won that game. So it gave me some good, you know, reasons to vote for them in the NCAA tournament. But do you last 2 weeks ago now, you know that we went to Cincinnati, right? We took a 17-hour trip from here to Cincinnati. And some of you are saying, now, wait a minute here. I've done that travel before. It's like 11 or 12 hours. Go with a bunch of teenagers and forerunners, and it will be 17 hours, I promise. And so we took that trip, and we went up there to Cincinnati and had an incredible time. And let me just tell you a side note. As we were there, they worked incredibly hard. One day they put out over 4,000 door hangers and just an incredible opportunity that they had. And just a praise to God, this past Sunday, you know, with Terry Lee and the Oaks Church had over 420 people in their services on Sunday morning. What an incredible, incredible Sunday they had there. But while I was there, Baylor was playing an NCAA tournament. And so the great news was I heard the score before I could see some of the replays, and Baylor had won. Here's the deal. I wasn't as excited as I was the week earlier when I saw that game against that other team that left the conference that I will not name. But I was very excited because I was watching that as it was happening. But I knew the score on the next game, and I was very calm. Now, why is that? Because I knew the answer, right? I knew the outcome. Here's what's exciting to me. This past Easter morning, we were celebrating the Resurrection Sunday, and I was sitting over here, and in the third service, I was thinking through some things. And I thought about some of the church starts our church has had. There's five churches celebrating with us Resurrection Sunday morning this past Sunday. And I thought about that, and they're here in the States, and I thought about how incredible it is for us to come together celebrating the resurrection of Christ, and we can do it in freedom, right? We can do it in safety, and we can not have to worry about the outside forces coming in because we could worship our Lord and Savior right there, and that's what we did that this past Sunday. But then I also thought about some of those churches that we start across the seas, you know, some of the ones in Nigeria and Benin, other places that you had a big part of starting. They don't have that privilege that we had. You know, they could even be celebrating the resurrection of Christ, maybe even in secrecy or even in fear of what could happen, but they were still celebrating the resurrected Christ. But you know what all of us have in common? when we were celebrating Christ Sunday morning, we knew the end of the story. We knew who won. We knew what the outcome was all about. And tonight, we're going to look at a couple guys who was having that conversation on Sunday afternoon, Easter Sunday. They had yet to have their meal, I think. I think that's where part of the problem was. But they're having this conversation, and we're just going to jump in and see what's going on with them. Because here's what's happening. We see here that here's Jesus. He's the risen king. He's victorious over death. We get to celebrate that here. We got to celebrate that Sunday morning. And if you don't hear anything else tonight, maybe you needed to hear those last three words or four words that Bill shared with us about that peace that Jesus gives us. I don't know your circumstances tonight. Maybe you're hurting. Maybe it's just been one of those years that has just been incredibly, incredibly bad. Maybe there's situations we don't even know about, but I can promise you this. Jesus knows. And he's telling you tonight there's going to be peace. And so maybe even tonight, before we even get started, you just need to know that in your life there could be peace. But also you need to know this, that in your life there can be purpose. Maybe you're a believer here in Christ tonight, and you're just looking for, God, what do you want me to do? I'm going to promise you there's purpose. But let's jump back here. Because here's what we remember. We remember here's these two guys on the road to Emmaus. And they're kind of defeated a little bit, if you will. You know, they don't know the end of the story. You know, the illustration about the Battle of Waterloo. You probably have heard that illustration before. Maybe in your history class. Or maybe you just heard it in one of somebody's sermon. But if you remember the illustration about the Battle of Waterloo, there was General Wellington, remember that? He was going up against Napoleon. And they were having that battle in Belgium in a city just south of Brussels. And the way that the people in England and Great Britain knew the outcome of the battle was by lights. You know, they would show the lights to hear the outcome. And so after that battle was over with, then they were telling the outcome, the answer to the nation of England, of Great Britain, and they got the words out. Wellington defeated, and just like that was very common in Great Britain, the fog set in. And so the fog set in, and so all that the people there, the Brits, saw was Wellington defeated. And so you can imagine how quickly that spread across the country. And when you know of a war going on and your enemy has won, what does that make you feel like? Very defeated. Well, all of a sudden, the fog lifted. And they could see the rest of the sentence. Wellington defeated Napoleon. Well, you can imagine the triumph in that country. You can imagine the transformation that happened from being defeated to the feeling of triumph. And that spread throughout the country. There was this thunderous celebration when the news was relayed. Can you think about those early disciples as they saw and they heard and experienced the message of the Lord Jesus Christ being raised again? Not even close to what happened here in the story, but that's what was happening. Because think about this. Think about the truth that death and sin has been defeated. What great news to share to the world. Let me jump back in the first part of Luke 24. And let me just share in verse 5, just a real quick statement here. And the Bible says this in Luke 24, 5. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? And let me just remind you about what this really kind of passage, this verse is about. Now here was the women at the tomb, remember? And they went in and they were searching for Jesus and he was not there. And they were defeated. And here comes the angels coming and sharing with them. And here's what they said. Why do you search for the living amongst the dead? And what was happening is that here's these early disciples, here's these ladies, and what they were doing, they were honoring a dead Savior. They were honoring a Savior who was like all other men, that they didn't have power over death. They were powerless of eternity. But the angels reminded them, Jesus, he's the Savior. He's the King of Kings. He was not a death Savior. He was a risen Savior. Because we remember in John 10:10, the Bible says this, the thief comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Now think about life is a great important word in scriptures. You know, life is eternal. It's forever. We see that in John 17:3. This is the eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and the one you have sent, Jesus Christ. See, eternal life is not only about duration, but what it's about, it's also about quality. A certain kind of life. A life that's consistent, that knows love, that knows joy, that knows power. But also we know this, that God is the source and the author of life. See, we also see that in John 1:4. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. See, life only comes to those believing in Jesus Christ. And so tonight, if we aren't in awe of the resurrection of Jesus as an historical event, then what's happening is it's just a fairy tale. See, if we're not in awe of the resurrection, because we know it's scientifically impossible, right? But it's historically true. The resurrection is history-making. We know that. But we also know this, that it shakes the earth up, doesn't it? You know, it shakes the world around us. It transforms life. But it's also eternity-changing truth. That's what we're talking about when we talk about the resurrection. You may believe it, but my question to you tonight is this. Do you understand how it changes your life? Now, you may understand the theology behind the resurrection, but my question to all of us tonight is this. Has it yet changed your behavior? That's what we're going to see here in Luke 24. So think about this. Here's these two followers of Jesus Christ who are walking home to Emmaus. They were having a conversation as they were traveling. Now, it was about the resurrection of Jesus. I mean, if you think about it, what shocking news. They probably haven't heard more shocking news than that ever in their lives. But then a stranger began to walk with them, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he began talking with them and been asking them questions. And they came back and said, have you not heard? They were astounded that he did not hear about all that had happened. But here's the thing, they didn't recognize Jesus. Now, when I read that, I have to be honest and I have to confess, the question comes to my mind, how can they not know that that was not Jesus? Do you ever ask that question? But here's these two guys walking to Emmaus. They're going home from all that has happened. They yet have not had their Easter lunch, I guess. But they're walking home, and here comes Jesus in the midst of them. They even invite him to home to dinner that night. And he's talking with them. How do they not know that that's not Jesus? I don't understand that, but then I have to go back and say this. Man, there's times in my life that Jesus is walking with me and things are happening and I don't see that it's Jesus. And if we're not careful, we all will do that. And so we look at that and here's the reason why. I think the first reason that that happens to us, and as believers in Christ, folks, let me tell you, that does happen. Even though we have Jesus in our lives, in our heart, he has saved us, our eternity is secure. There's times that we don't see Jesus at work in our lives. There's times that we don't see Jesus in our lives. And here's one of the reasons I think is the reason why that we don't see Jesus is because we're too busy. Now think about it. Here's these two disciples. They were walking down a 7-mile stretch of road and they were hurried to get home. Look at verse 14. The Bible says this, and they talked together of all these things which had happened. See, it was late in the afternoon. And as you can imagine, they were caught up in the events of the weekend. And what an incredible weekend they had experienced. But you see, they had places to go. Can you relate to that? They had things to do. They had people to see. They were busy. The problem with being busy is that we miss out on the most important events in life. Now we know if we get too busy, we'll miss our kids growing up, won't we? If we get too busy, we'll ignore our spouse's needs. We'll sacrifice our health, both emotionally, physically, and spiritually. But here's the good news tonight. Do you know wherever we are in this part of our lives that Jesus says he will take us right where we're at? Isn't that good news tonight? That no matter where you find yourself at tonight, you know, maybe you can experience and you relate to these two guys walking back home on the road to Emmaus, not having a clue that Jesus is right there with them. Maybe you can relate to that, but Jesus said, you know what, I'm right there with you. I'll take you right where you're at. Just come to me. Or even more than that, maybe you're not even on the road to Emmaus. Maybe you're not even talking about Jesus. Maybe that's the last thing on your mind. But the great news is this. Jesus says, I'll take you right where you're at. You know what? Maybe you're the smartest in your Sunday school class. Maybe you have all the answers. Maybe people think your life is going fantastic, and maybe it is. But you know what the good news for you is? Jesus will take you right where you're at. Because here's the folks, here's the this folks, we're all on a level playing ground. No matter what position we find ourselves in, no matter what situation we find ourselves in, we're on that level playing ground, and Jesus says, I am right there for you. So we get busy, don't we? But also the problem is that we're not looking for Jesus. Have you ever looked for something? Can I share another confession? Good, because, you know, I'm up here, and so I'll do it. You know, a few weeks ago, I was on my way to church. It was a Monday morning. Don't you love Monday mornings? And I had my Bible with me, and I laid my Bible up on the counter, and I went to get my keys, and I couldn't find my keys. Have you ever experienced not finding your keys? Have you had to look everywhere in the house? And I just had them the night before. Did you know what I did on Sunday night? I was at church. And do you know where I went from church on Sunday night? I went on the road on 77. It wasn't Emmaus, but it was 77 on the way home. And I went home from church on Sunday night. And when I got home, you know what I did with my keys? Well, I didn't know either. And so I couldn't find them. And I looked, and I looked, and I looked. Do you know how frustrating it is to look for keys when you can't find them? Well, I finally just gave up, and I didn't say anything bad out loud, and so I was feeling real good, and so I was getting ready to call Brenda and tell her, all right, come get me. I can't find them, so I sat down. And where do you put your keys at, when you get done with your keys, where do you put your keys at? In your pocket? Did somebody say in the front pocket? That's where I put my keys at. I sat down, and I felt them in my back pocket. Do you know how escalating, if you're already in a bad mood, that can happen when you find out the keys were on you the whole time and you look for something, but you finally found them? Instead of being in a good mood, it kind of takes you over the edge. Well, when I finally realized how exciting it was to have keys and so I could get to the church, you know, I thought about something. If we're not careful, we'll let things like this ruin our relationship with others, and even our relationship that day with the Lord. Because problems, if we're not careful, we don't look for Jesus. And these two disciples, they did not recognize Jesus because they were not looking for him. Now, they were talking about him. Now, they had not made the connection between Jesus' promise in Jerusalem and Jesus' presence in Emmaus, on the road to Emmaus. Because, see, Jesus promised that he would rise again, what? On that third day. But doubt and misunderstanding made it impossible for them to recognize this man as Jesus. And I love irony. Irony, okay? Some of you probably like irony as well. And I looked at this text, and I was thinking about this, and you know me, and if you do, I like to pick out things. And here's what's interesting to me. Here's these guys walking on the road to Emmaus, and what day is it? It's Resurrection Sunday, right? It's Resurrection Sunday, and so that Sunday morning, what happened? Jesus was resurrected. You know, and then we look at this, and what had the woman discovered earlier that morning? What did they discover? An empty tomb, right. And what did the angels announce to those who went to the grave? That Jesus was alive. Now, this is all on that same day, right? And what did the other disciples discover when they visited Jesus' burial place? An empty tomb, So amongst this group, remember these guys on the road to Emmaus were disciples of Jesus, right? And so here's these guys, and the evidence of Jesus returning to life was growing. The evidence of his resurrection was overwhelming. But these two did not see Jesus on the road that day simply because they were not looking for him. See, their conversation wasn't just about the details of the resurrection. It was also about who he was supposed to be, who he was supposed to be in life, who he was supposed to be in death, and all that that meant. So we have a remarkable ability to shut God out of our lives, don't we? Each of us do, if we're not careful. See, we have a tendency to put on blindfolds and go through the day as if Jesus did not cross the paths of our life. And don't tell me you don't do that at times, because I know you do. But we all do. We don't treat the resurrection as some cold truth that you've always heard about. So tonight, let's Jesus' resurrection change our conversation, right? Let Jesus' resurrection, let that be something that we talk about this week with the same excitement as if it just happened. But also, think about this. See, we let life prevent us from seeing Jesus. Verse 17, the Bible says, and he said to them, what kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad? See, these two were walking along the road. They were down and out. They were not happy. They were sad. Matter of fact, the New English Bible describes them as full of gloom. Have you ever been around anybody full of gloom? Those people who are depressed, those who have tried to, you try to help someone else, and they say this, it's something to the effect that, yeah, I understand, but. Or maybe they say something like this, or that's fine for you to say, but they don't listen to you. You know, maybe they're just, everything that they hear is bad news. This is kind of what was going on here. They ignore the truth, even when the truth just basically smacks them in the face. So here's the reality is, that when things seem bad, no matter who you are, look at the resurrected Christ. Look to him. But not only do we let life prevent us from seeing Jesus, and I'm going to step on some toes here, I know, but sometimes our attitudes keeps us from seeing Jesus. Do you know anybody like that? Yeah, don't raise your hand probably on that. But if we're not careful, our attitudes will keep us from seeing Jesus. While the two are on the road to Emmaus, they had heard the possibility of Jesus being raised from the dead. The problem is they simply did not believe it. They didn't believe it at this time. It was just too good to be true. See, Jesus, with these two disciples, still not knowing who he is, Jesus called them a couple of what? Foolish people, right? Call them a bunch of fools. He rebuked them, and then he began a Bible study during the journey. Can you imagine that Bible study? That's the greatest Bible study the world has ever known. Here's Jesus walking with those two on the road to Emmaus. And the Bible says that he started with them from the beginning to the end of the Old Testament. Now think about it. If there was any conversation that you would ever want to be a part of or to overhear, this would be it. Because Jesus began with the book of Moses, you know, the Pentateuch, and he ended and led them through the prophets, you know, ending with Malachi. And what an incredible Bible study that was. See, the Old Testament promised and prophesied this whole point, Jesus' resurrection. Let me kind of do a side note here. When you're doing your devotions, when you're in your Bible studies class, your Sunday school class, your life group class, your large groups, maybe your small groups, but when you're reading through the Bible, let me remind you that Jesus is one that gives us example that everything in the Bible points us to Jesus Christ. Everything points us to the resurrection. So when you go through the Bible, if you're trying to figure out how do I relate this, how do I read this passage, Jesus tells us right here, point it to Jesus Christ. Point it to the resurrection. You know, Jesus' resurrection changes our lives, changes who we are. And so as I kind of close and wrap this up, let me just remind you this. As Jesus revealed his true identity to his disciples, he taught them a very important truth, that the gospel presentation explains how their lives will change because of that truth. Repentance and forgiveness should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning with Jerusalem. Let me read this passage to you. Look at verses 45 through 49. So here's Jesus. He got to these two on the road to Emmaus. They didn't recognize him. He goes to their house, right? They finally recognize who he is, but here's what Jesus said. Jesus said to them, "Thus is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day." Listen to that. It was necessary for that to happen. "And that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with the power from on high." Don't miss this. Repentance does not just mean to turn away from sin. That's only part of the truth. Repentance also means turning to Jesus. That's what we see here in this passage. Forgiveness means that God will not hold his judgment against us for a sin because Jesus has been judged in our place. Now, what an incredible truth that is for us tonight. And as we look at this passage, we see the word nations there, and that means that not one person on earth that does not need to hear the gospel truth, the gospel story. See, here's what I love about this church. Here's what I love that I see every Sunday, and we come here on Wednesday nights. But witnessing lost people turn from their sin and to Jesus. What a great joy that is. Can I share with you my fear? That God has blessed this church so dramatically in seeing people come to know Christ, that every time we see somebody in that baptistry that has given their life to Christ, that maybe we're forgetting and missing just a little bit of the miracle that has just happened. You know, churches that see it once a year, it's an amazing thing to them, isn't it? Now, should that just happen once a year? No. But there are churches who sometimes don't even baptize anybody throughout the year. But God has blessed us here to see people come and give their lives to Christ. Don't take that for granted. Don't miss the miracle that happens when a life is changed. Don't miss the miracle that happens when God saves somebody for eternity. You want to see miracles? Don't miss a Sunday morning. You'll see baptisms that happen. People's lives are changed. But let me go on and close with this. You know, the disciples, you know, they did not lack for evidence about the resurrection, did they? I think one of the things that they lacked at this point was hope. Was that hope? See, Jesus is the one who has time for us even when we feel we don't have time for him. Hear that. Well, also we know this, that he's the one who's looking for us even when we are not looking for him. See, Jesus is the one who will replace our sadness with joy. He is the one who will give us hope even in the midst of our doubts. See, Jesus is the one who will give life to a dead existence. The Bible says in Luke 24:49, "Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with the power upon high." Let me just kind of remind you what's happening here and close with this. You know, the Great Commission follows, right? Acts 1, we see that. Here's Luke telling us here in Luke 24 all that happens. And then he's reminding us, too, that Jesus told them to stay right there in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes. Because, folks, we can't do anything on our own power. It's the Holy Spirit working through us that allows us to do what God has called us to do. All of us as believers. And so Jesus told them to wait. Wait right there for the Holy Spirit. And why is that? Because we can't do anything without the Holy Spirit in our lives. So don't miss this truth. When you have a question and you need an answer, look in Scripture. You will find that it's because it's right in front of you. Because see, we know the end of the story. You know, there was a guy in Virginia, a Virginian, that he moved to the coast of Florida. And he built a house. And in this house, he made a large picture window. And he could see the Gulf. And he was talking to a friend back home. They said, "Well, tell us about it. How do you like it?" He said, "There's only one problem. There's nothing to see." But at the same time, there's a guy, a Floridian from the Gulf Coast, that moved to Virginia. And he built a house. And he put a picture window in it as well. And it was overlooking the Blue Ridge Mountains. And a friend from home called him and said, tell us about it. And he said, there's only one problem, is I can't see anything. The mountains are in the way. Do you know your perspective is what it's all about? You know, God has given us opportunities. And John, the disciple John, he did not have a problem when Jesus revealed to him the glories of heaven. Now, Revelations 12:1 said, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea existed no longer. He said, there's no more sea. And basically, what does that mean? There's no more difficulty. Because, see, the sea kept him from going home. The sea kept him from going to work. The sea kept him from his family, from his friends. And in verse 6 of Revelation 21, the Bible says this. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I'll give to the thirsty from the spring of living water as a gift. See, God has told us the end of the story. We know our destination. So as we close here tonight, I'm going to ask our worship team to go ahead and make their way this way. But as we close tonight, here's what I want to ask of you. We just celebrated an incredible Sunday, Easter Sunday. But the reality of the fact is this, every Sunday is Easter Sunday. We should have that same experience in our own personal lives as we did this past Sunday. But there's are people that are in your life that they don't have that reality in their life. Now, they may know of Jesus. They may talk of Jesus like these two on the road to Emmaus did. And Jesus was right there in their presence, but they didn't know him. But you may know people in your life that do not know Jesus, the Lord and Savior. I want you to think about them as we close as well. Pray for them. But tonight, a great, great opportunity that God gives us on Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings. And I love the fact that our church believes that God can change people's lives, even on Wednesday nights. So we do a thing called an invitation. And so maybe tonight you're here and you're saying, you know, I can understand those two guys on the road to Emmaus. You know, I get it. Because I don't understand all that's happening, but I want to know. Maybe you just want to talk to one of the staff here and just say, give me some answers to these questions I have. We'd love to talk to you. Or maybe tonight, you're a believer in Christ, and you are a disciple of God. But you have not placed your service here at Highland Park. And God's saying, I want you here in the ministry of this church. Well, wait. Go ahead and join the membership of this church. Be active. Do what God's called you to do. And I love the fact that we had this baptism tonight. Because I know in a crowd this size, I always know that there's a person who knows Christ as Lord and Savior who has yet to follow the Lord and believe his baptism because they've maybe been baptized once before, maybe as a baby, or maybe like I was when I was a teenager and I went forward and I asked, and they asked me, do you want to join the church? And I said, yes. And I did. I joined the church and I was baptized. I went into water. But no one ever asked me, do I want to know Christ? And so it wasn't until almost a year later until I came to know Christ as Lord and Savior. So maybe you were baptized before you became a Christian, and you just need to get that right tonight. And say, hey, I want to make an example. I want the world to know that I'm a follower of Christ. But more importantly, probably tonight throughout this room, as believers in Christ, your decision tonight is let God speak to you about those people, that person in your life, that does not have that Easter story that we have about the resurrection. They don't have that relationship. And I know you've been praying for them, but maybe tonight you just need to pray again for them. So the altars are open, or maybe you just do it right there in your seat where you're at, but pray for them. I'm going to pray for us, and after I pray, I'm going to have you stand. And as you stand, if there's a decision you need to make, you make that decision. Or if there's someone you need to pray for, you come to the altar, pray for them, or pray for them right where you're at. But just to listen to God tonight, as he brought us here to this Wednesday night service. Father, tonight we give this service to you. Father, it's not about what was said, but about who we said it about. And so we just pray, and we know that you change lives. And so we just pray tonight that you make a difference. Make a difference in our lives as believers. And Father, there's someone here that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior. Father, continue to work on them right now. But Father, if decisions are need to be made here tonight, let us make them. But we give it to you, for we ask this in Christ's name.